You can still get your life back. Get your life back. It's real. Get your life back. Get your life back.
Hey, everybody. Welcome, welcome, welcome. So glad you tuned in. We're at the end of the year almost. My gosh. But for those of you who don't know me, my name is Cheryl Howard. Some of you know that I'm an inspirational transformation strategist. I am a certified life purpose coach, a speaker, a best-selling author, and a pastoral counselor, and a mental health professional. But anyway, welcome to Cheryl's Get Your Life Back podcast. At the beginning of this year, I did a live video talking about a 2020 vision and, you know, see what 2020 has brought so much. There's so much that we can say about 2020. But I wanted to do a wrap-up of 2020, what kind of all of the things that we've gone through, and that's why I'm going to name this podcast, All of the Things 2020. And then I want to do my wrap-up here, and then we'll talk about going into 2021, what that might look like for you, what that might look like for me, and all of the things that we are praying about. So that's what I really want to focus on today. We've experienced so much. We experienced good. We experienced some bad things. We experienced some ugly things this year. And then we also experienced some successes. A lot of us had successes during this time, the pandemic going on and all throughout the protests and all the stuff that we encountered this year, especially in the United States. There's some good news, you know, and thank God for that, that in the midst of it all, it's good to hear some good news, some good stories, some successes, people achieving some goals, people transforming, transitioning. And so, you know, a lot of times we need to start focusing on those things because we've been through so many things that's been negative in 2020, we got to find a source of light, a source of strength, inspiration, and motivation. And you know, that's what I'm all about. For those of you who follow me, if you don't follow me, I need you to go to, find me on YouTube. You can subscribe and like, but you can also find me on Instagram, Cheryl.GetYourLifeBack. YouTube, Cheryl Howard, Get Your Life Back Inspirational Coaching, but you can just put Get Your Life Back, you gotta do all that. I'm also on Facebook at Cheryl Howard, Get Your Life Back. So if you type in Cheryl White Howard, Get Your Life Back, I'll pop up somewhere on the internet streets, okay? But anyway, I'm glad you tuned in today. I really want your comments, well, you know, on this video, on YouTube, or wherever you watch this at. I would like to get some feedback and maybe we can continue the conversation. But yes, I want to talk about all of the things 2020. I'm so glad today because I'm not by myself. I actually have a guest. I don't always want to be the only one speaking. So I'm getting back into having some more guests on my podcast. Some of them will be interviews, but today I'm just going to have like a co-host type guest. And I'm going to give an intro about him and then I'm going to bring him on. His name is David Towns, also known as Dave LT, because he is an artist, he's a musician, he's a visionary, he's a man of God, he's a minister, I think that's a musician, and so much more. And I wanted to bring him in as my buddy, my friend, my beau, my pal, all that good stuff, right? And I wanted him to join me today so we can just kind of talk about this thing and I'll engage him in a conversation. And I want you to engage as well. So I need you to leave some comments. I know this is not live, but I'll go back and I'll read the comments and also answer them as well. So without further ado, I welcome David Towns, known as Dave LT.
Hey, what's up, everybody? I'm Dave LT here. How y'all doing? What's up?
Hey, so you all right? How are you?
I'm great, great. Things are well. Thanks for asking.
Good. So we're on different sides of town. I'm in the VA, and David is in the MI, which is Michigan.
I'm in the D. Peace.
So what I want to first ask you is, how's the weather out there? Because I know it's different in Virginia.
Well, here today, it's kind of mildly. The weather is, we have about 55 degrees. A little snowy, okay. Wet ground, but we're doing great. You know, it's something we're not even, it's common here, so I'm used to it.
Right. Yeah. But that's not bad for today, 55, because I know you had some 30-degree weather already.
Yes, we did. Absolutely.
And, you know Virginia, it's up and down.
Yes, I've seen you
so
guys.
So it might be 70 today, and then it could be 30 tomorrow.
Absolutely, yeah.
So I call it bipolar weather, but you know, we got that in New York too.
Yep. Seen that too.
Yeah, man. I mean, it's so much. 2020 is crazy, as you and I talked about. So many things that happen, and we try to find some kind of light, some kind of inspiration.
Yes.
You know, to look at, because that's how we have to cope. We don't want to lose it. You know, we don't want to lose our sanity. It's new. It's, you know, because this is not normal. And I even tell, you know, friends, family, and even clients I work with, it's not normal to experience so much pain and death, like consecutively like that, so constant.
Absolutely.
So by the time you recover from one thing, you hear about something else. Somebody lost their life. I mean, it's just so much going on. And that's why I want to do a wrap up about 2020, because I know a lot of us came into 2020. We was ready. 2020 vision. I'm ready to live my life. I'm ready to do some great things. And wham, here come the pandemic. Wham, here come more, you know, the killing and stuff going on with racial violence. There's just so much that we have to contend with this year. And we have to expect better. We always have to look ahead, but we have to be aware of what we've gone through.
Yes, we do.
You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
So that's why I have to talk about the successes and the goals, because a lot of us had goals, and some of those goals might have been deferred or delayed, right?
Absolutely.
Because of what we're experiencing. But I don't want anybody to give up on their goals. Sometimes, you know, things in life, those things happen sometimes. So sometimes you just have to wait. Keep praying and keep believing and pray and all that stuff.
That's right.
The first, and I had to get my little notes down because I don't want to forget. I first want to talk about the good. Let's start up on a good foot. And I'm going to ask you some things too, David, maybe some personal things that you're working on or something that's, you know, that's new. But I know one thing I can say personally, the good that happened to me, and then I'll talk about overall, out of this whole situation, the midst of it all, I was able to maybe launch some new, you know, products and services.
Yes.
And it's about meeting a need. I don't know if you remember, I did a whole self-care workshop.
Mm-hmm.
Because I was acknowledging the mental health, the trauma that people's experiencing, and then reminding people of finding ways to kind of take care of themselves, you know, in the midst of everything. Because we neglect, you know, ourselves a lot. And we busy, and we don't take our time to breathe.
Yes, that's common.
Right. Mm-hmm. And you know me, I can, you know, have ways of being hyper when I'm ready, I'm energetic, I'm ready to work towards something, but I always remind myself to take a break, take a breather. You know, I have my little shows I like to watch. Those are my little outlets.
Yes.
Especially mentally, because I'm always doing mental work.
I know.
So I got to find stuff to kind of deter me from that and just be fantasy land sometime. You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
And I think about what's going on.
Absolutely.
So what have you been doing? What have you been, before I get into what have you been up to, how are you coping through all of this stuff that's going on?
Well, prayerfully, for me, it's more or less staying abreast of what's going on and staying prayerful about it, because we dealt with a lot of stuff at the beginning of this year as well as up to now.
Right.
A lot of racial profiling, a lot of issues where we lost a lot of brothers.
Right.
Based on police brutality. And so the only thing that I can do, how I cope with this, I pray. Of course, I talk to people about it. I talk to certain people, individuals who have gone through that, have been through situations like that, to find out how they cope with it. And so letting them know that somebody's here, we're there for you, we're standing with you, and just to know that things, as we pray, we'll get better. And so it's always looking forward for things to get better in that instance right there.
Right.
So it's good.
You bring me to my next thing, because I was going to talk about one thing I have saw that I've been praying for a long time, is that we get back to a sense of community where we look out for one another.
Absolutely.
Because I think in the midst of being busy and going to get out, whatever we try to get, we forget to check on our neighbor. You remember back in the day, that was so common. You know, the neighbors looked out for each other's kids. We checked on our neighbor. We checked on Miss Mary next door. Miss Mary, you all right?
We used to.
You know, how you doing? If somebody needs something to eat, I mean, all of that. And that's one thing I did see happen because of what we've gone through. Number one, because what our race faced, you know, as a Black community, getting back to checking on everybody. How you doing? You know, you have a need, maybe pray for you, whatever. But also as a whole, of all the cultures that kind of live here, even across the world, because, you know, this pandemic itself has hit a lot of people, but even the protests, we know that's worldwide too, because we see protests in Europe and everything.
Yes.
And so many other people that was for, you know, in support of us as a culture. I see more unity, sense of community, and my prayer is always that that lasts. That's my fear, that it doesn't last. It's like for a moment, we go right back to our isolation, me, myself, and I.
Well, before we had a generation where everybody was responsible for everybody.
Right.
We had mothers in the neighborhood who always stand in privy, I'm sorry, not privy, stand in proxy, rather, of other mothers who work during the day for their kids. So when you got in trouble, you not only got to work from the neighbor, you got to work from your mom when she got home.
Right.
And so again, like you mentioned earlier, it was more community. You know, everybody worked for everybody. It was a village, if you will. And so we all sought to look out for everybody, all the kids, everybody in the neighborhood, and it just worked out pretty well then. But now we've lost that sense of adhesiveness, if you will. And so now it's more or less a generation that's kind of like far from where we came from, trying to raise another generation and just kind of perpetuates on losing love. Yeah.
Right. That's so true. So I really hope that we learn something from that and realize how important it is to look after each other. And it is a village.
Yes.
Like you always say, it's a village. I don't care if you're an adult or a child. It takes a village, you know, to support each other. So I did see that. So I could say that's some positive things that have happened, you know, the good in 2020. The whole focus, I said, like on self-care, but mental health. There's been more awareness spreading around about how important it is to take care of our mental health. And that mental health don't have to have a negative stigma. Mental health is just taking care of yourself. It can be learning how to cope with stuff, you know, not being so stressed, not having so many anxieties, and doing things to kind of help decrease those symptoms of anxiety and stress and depression. Yes. And again, the village helped with that a lot too, you know, having support around. You know, and even the nature of the work that I do, one of the things we always try to do, you know, with, you know, mental health clients is asking them who is their source of support, because we know as human beings, that's important for everybody to have. Mm-hmm. Some of us just made it through some things, to be honest with you, because we have support. Without support, friends and some family members, I know stuff I've gone through, I don't know how I would have made it through or how would it came out, what kind of mindset.
Absolutely.
Because I had, like for me, the support was the church, my church family, my biological family, and I had a lot of friends.
Absolutely.
And we were there for each other, but a lot of people don't have that. I have a lot of people that, I work with, they're by themselves. And I'm always reminded they don't have that. So it's part of my job sometimes to kind of connect them and help them access different community supports that they may not even know about. When people depress and they have anxiety, sometimes they don't have the initiative to do that stuff.
Right.
So somebody, and that's what I mean by support too, somebody got to be that link. So it's like linkage, that linkage and referral for us.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And that's what we got to get back to.
Yes.
But yeah, mental health is so important. Restoring a sense of community. So that's definitely something I wanted to cover. But yeah, the whole Black Lives Matter movement, I think that was a good thing. It was a very good thing. Reminding us, because you know our culture, we came from that village where we looked out. Everybody was the aunties and the uncles in the neighborhood.
That's right.
Even back to Africa, that's how it was. And so just seeing us come together in unity, it made some changes. Some people may disagree or argue, but it made some changes. It got people's attention.
Yes.
You know, like this is it. Like the next generation is like, okay, for every other movement that took place, that had to take place, that was for that time. But now, you know, our children, they have their own movement. They're tired of things. They have more access to things as well. So they can do even, they can continue to work. It makes me think about when Jesus, you know, said he had, you know, left it up to us as he go back to the Father to do greater works.
Yes.
It doesn't mean we have more power than he is. People misinterpret that greater, but we will continue the work and do even more because all the years that's going to, but he's empowering us to do it. He lives inside of us. So we're going to, because we can't do it without him. Nobody need to get it twisted. Everything we do is with the power of God, but we're going to continue to do more and more and reach more. So I see it in that way.
I was going to say that word, the greater means it's more of us than one of him.
Yes.
So he reaches out through us. Through the kingdom, through the people of God. So it's more of us,
Exactly.
So,
So that was a lot of the good stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, we got to talk about the bad stuff.
Yes.
Oh my God. The pandemic, number one.
Yes. Yes.
Affected so many people. I don't even know the number right now. I should have looked it up before I got on, but I forgot the number now. But it's still too high. To me, one death is too much.
Yes.
From the pandemic.
Absolutely.
I had lost, you know, I lost loved ones. I lost family members and friends. I lost church members. So for me, it's been an emotional roller coaster up and down. And I'm being aware of that too. I've gone through a lot emotionally. And then I lost people in between from other illnesses in the midst. So that's why I said it's important to have the self-awareness, because I'm aware that that's some trauma. That's traumatic to experience that many multiple deaths. You know, usually a year go by, maybe two people, somebody died, and maybe it'd be a long time for somebody else, but almost every week or every other month,
yes,
that's a lot of bad news to take in. So it does affect you, and some people don't realize it, but I like to, you know, be aware of that.
Yes.
yeah, this pandemic is something else. And I know, you know, you guys, you're in a big city too. Well, I'm thinking I'm still living in New York. But anyway, but Richmond is a decent sized city. But I mean, such a big city, to try to control the spread is challenging.
Yeah, we've just lost our chief police chief this week. Yeah.
Oh my God.
Yeah, we just lost him, and so it's a great loss. He's done a great job in terms of being police chief, and he fell sick about maybe 2 months ago, and he finally succumbed to it, and he lost his life. And so
from COVID.
Yes, COVID-19.
Oh my God, didn't know that. That's terrible.
Yes.
Oh my gosh, yeah, stuff like that.
Yeah.
It makes it real when it comes closer to your door, especially, you know.
Absolutely.
So, yeah. You know, praying that this thing becomes, you know, gets under control.
Yeah.
I know it's been a lot of other plagues years and years ago. I was actually trying to go back and research and see how they dealt with that and how long those plagues last. I've seen it, but I got to go back and look at it. But it's unimaginable. It's really unimaginable what's going on. It's surreal for me. I have to be reminded, like, we're in the midst of a pandemic. Like,
exactly.
People are really dying from this thing.
It's unfathomable to think about. A year ago, we would have never thought this would happen.
Never.
We would never imagine walking around with a mask all day long.
No.
Being 6 feet apart.
Right.
This whole social distancing thing. We never thought that. You see, and that just goes to show you that you never know what's coming for. So, again, we have to be able to support each other and be prayerful in a productive way. Or should say proactive way. I should say proactive. And so, you know, I think that... Obama spoke about this years ago, about we need to be positioned right in case something like this does happen.
Right.
We need to know how to respond and how to react. And he spoke about being proactive, but I guess nobody listened.
Proactive.
So here we are now. Here we are now. Yeah.
Tell number 45, keyword, proactive.
That's it.
Oh my God.
Hey, Obama.
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
Obama. Pandemic. I did have a question that kind of left my mind. You said something that made me think of something else. With being prepared, being proactive. Oh, that we never would have seen this even coming. I think what happens is sometimes we don't think about it constantly all day, but when I go outside and see us walking around a mask, it becomes real again. It's like, wow, we are living. And there's other countries who've done this, like across Asia. But for us, it's like, We have to wear masks, and we have to be reminded. I know that happens to you sometimes. You get frustrated because it's like, oh my God, my mask. You got to go back to the car.
Right, it's
so much. It's like, to me, it's more mental work we got to do, because now we got to be reminded to take your mask. If you want to use gloves sometime when you pump that gas or whatever you do and throw the gloves away, we got to be so extra conscious now about everything.
Keep in mind, you know, this is worldwide now. This is not this is worldwide.
Exactly.
And so, yeah, it's I'm telling you, it's really it's really mind-boggling. To know this is our norm now.
Right.
This is the norm.
It's like, we didn't want to say that, but it's
Yeah, it is.
It's crazy. Good Lord, we thank God He's powerful and able to remove everything, but now we have to live through it. So
absolutely. Yeah.
Because I'm so tired of talking about Trump or hearing stuff. I'm sorry. I'm just real. I can't. I don't never wish anything bad to anybody. I just want God to remove him from office.
That's been done.
See what the next leader is going to do. All we have is people's promises and what they want to do, right? We don't know what people are going to do till they get in office. But we know what we have in office now, and we know that he needs to be removed. So that's just all I got to say on the matter.
Okay. Yeah.
Because to me, he's just sowing bad fruit. I don't see how it's edifying us as a nation of people, for all people. You know what I'm saying? So I'm tired of that whole dilemma. That's something we had to encounter and contend with as well. Behaviors, the whole narcissistic behavior. I mean, I saw it from the beginning. And so people's calling, I was like, he got clear symptoms of a narcissist, what a narcissist does, and not caring about other people. And he's not that type of person. He's not community oriented. A leader have to care about the nation, the people. You know what I'm saying?
I was going to say that.
Yeah.
I don't think his desire to be president was authentic. I think it was more of a notch in his belt.
Exactly.
I think he, this is not against him, but what I believe is that it was not a true desire to be a leader of the country. It was more or less right. a notch in his belt to say, I've accomplished this, I've accomplished that, and got this and did that and the other. I don't think he had an authentic desire to, for our benefit at all.
No.
But I'm praying for him.
I still got to pray. Right.
Yeah, but not that. You know me, I got it. Yeah.
No, we pray. Look, I said many prayers. Trust me.
Yeah.
And he was used as a sheep goat. I always said he was used as a sheep goat to carry out the agenda of particular people, particular parties. And
yes.
I will be right there. Yeah. Lord, have your way. We talked about the losses. That was some bad stuff. The racial profile crimes. Now, David, now I know you've gone through something recently. If you don't mind sharing, because you have experienced that whole racial profiling, being pulled over by the police.
Numerous times.
Oh, Jesus. Where were you? What was happening?
Well, I was returning
back. I know you're leaving VA, but go ahead.
I was leaving VA on my way back. And on the highway, I can't remember what highway it was. And I saw him pull aside of me on his way to pass me.
Right.
When he saw I was a black man, everything changed.
Mm.
Then he rescinded. He got behind me. Mm-hmm. He stayed behind me for about maybe about 10 minutes. Right when I crossed, I think the I-70, something like that. And he decided to activate his overheads. So that's his light. So he pulled me over. He said, how you doing, sir? I said, I'm fine. I said, what's the problem? He said, well, I pulled you over because you were speeding. You were doing 72 and 65 back on the other highway, and I waited to pull you over because I need to get you clear. I said, is that so? So long story short, it was harassment. It was pure harassment.
Right.
To say the least, he said, wait here. After I gave him my credentials, he said, wait here. He went back to his vehicle, his patrol car. He called in another cop, by the way. And then he called in another cop. The third cop was the canine unit. Now, those of you who know the canine unit, that's the dog who searches out your vehicle for contraband or narcotics.
Exactly.
So he gets me out the car. He says, listen, the dog has picked up a scent of narcotics in your car. So I'm explaining to him. I said, listen, I don't do drugs. It was a rental. It was a rental.
Right.
I said, now, I don't know who had the vehicle before me, but I don't have any contraband or drugs in the car. So he proceeded to search the car. While doing that, he's giving me all these questions, coming at me with all the questions. And so the whole thing was really kind of, it was racial profiling. It clearly was.
Right.
It was not really embarrassing, but a shame to our law enforcement, because we're still dealing with the same issues that have been going on for years. Back in the 60s, 70s, and 80s, actually before then, really.
Right.
So it was really a stressful situation. Wasn't scared for my life. You know, he didn't pull his gun or anything like that. He seemed very calm about it, both officers. But why waste my time 30 minutes because you see a black man on the freeway and you assume he's doing something against the law?
Right.
So it was bad. It could have turned out worse.
Right.
But I was civil. I rode right with him. I didn't kick back. I didn't refute anything because I'm trying to live.
It's right.
Now, I could have went another way. He could have been another cop. I could have been another black man.
Right.
So I thank God that God held my composure to walk in a very, first of all, in a Christian way, because
right.
I could have lost my temper.
Right.
And walk in a civil, you know, just in a way that say, listen, I don't have anything to hide. Go through the vehicle. So long story short, he gave me a ticket. Well, actually, he gave me a warning and said, you're fine. You're free to leave. And so that was the situation right there. But like you were saying, though, it could have turned out worse.
Yeah, I was on the other line for you people.
Yes.
And I was like, David, just try to comply.
Because you know,
I need you to be safe.
Yes.
I need you to get home. If you
right.
need to complain, we're going to do that later.
Yes, because
I was nervous. I went into prayer. I was like, oh my God, Jesus, Lord. Because remember, the phone disconnected.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's
yeah.
when I was like, oh my God, okay. Yeah. And I started praying. I was like, Lord, please. And you said I was like, David, just stay calm.
Yes, because I wanted to go. Let me be honest with you all.
Yeah.
I wanted to go off because I knew it was bogus. I knew it was not a legitimate pullover. He had no reason to pull me over.
He was not speeding like that.
Let me say this. It's that fear in them that we're, but I won't go there. But
no,
anyway,
that's
what happened. I wanted to go off, but I didn't. And the Lord brought me through, and I ended up getting home. So thank God for that.
I was like, oh my God, you know, I was calling everybody, pray. I called one of my prayer warriors. I called my daughter. I was just like,
right, right, right.
Just being prepared. You know, that's what helps other people sometimes. Just Oh my God. So I was only the phone disconnected. I was like, I wanted to see what was going to happen. I couldn't wait to be far back. I was like, what in the world? Especially when you said they brought the canine. Then you said it was a van or a truck or something that came, another vehicle?
Yes, it was three altogether. It was the first cop that pulled me over. It was a second car behind him, and then there was a canine unit. Now, keep in mind, Cheryl, this is not the first time this happened. I've traveled back from New York and Ohio. Same situation, same problem, same, same, unquote, pulled over because you were whatever he said. But we know that's not the reason why.
Right.
So,
you got a van, a rental van, dark color van, black man.
Yeah.
Riding in the car, like, okay, the dog smells out. Okay, whatever.
Yeah.
Because we human. So, yeah, sometimes you want to, it's bad. It's so sad that we can't even practice our rights, like have the right to even ask them why I'm pulled over and all of that stuff. Because you got just the fact that you ask them, they get the ones that are bad. They get the ones who are emotionally dysregulated, they get angry, and they become defensive. So it's almost like you feel scared to even ask, well, officer, why did you pull me over? What did I do? Did you see what happened with people? Just by asking a question, they're not here today. So of course my mind went there for a moment, like, don't even ask. Don't get upset. Try to stay emotionally regulated as much as possible. Oh, this is what I was praying. Like, oh my God.
Their goal, and we're not going to say this too long, their goal is to search your vehicle. That's what he wanted to do.
Right.
So
right.
he didn't, rather than asking for my consent to do it, he created a situation where I had to comply with it.
Right.
I wasn't gonna fight back anymore. I wasn't gonna play along with it. So
I'm playing for my black man, black bro.
Right.
That was whoo.
Yeah.
It was kind of close. But it's funny, I'm thinking about that those symptoms of like that PST symptom when a lot of us are dealing with now. When we see the police now, a lot of us automatically like, oh my God, we tense up.
Yes.
And they put their sirens on. And that happened to me. I told you maybe it was in the summertime, beginning of this year, actually.
Mm-hmm.
And I was turning a corner down a particular street I take all of the time. The police had pulled another car over, but one policeman was standing outside. So as I was turning, I'm not speeding, I hear this white officer go, pull over. I mean, he said it so loud.
Yes.
I didn't hear him at first. I'm focused. My windows are up. I got music on. I'm headed towards... I forgot where I was going. I think I was going to meet a client.
Mm-hmm.
And I heard it a second time. And then I looked out my rear view window. I was like, oh, he's talking to me. He said it again. Pull over. I'm telling you, at that moment, it's like my heart jumped into my stomach.
Wow.
Because the yelling. And I'm like, what did I do? You know, and remember, this is in the midst. So it had to be like around, maybe it was kind of beginning of the summer, maybe around May or June or something like that. Because it was in the midst of what's going on. You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
Everything that's happening and I'm thinking about all the brothers that got killed by the police and all
yes.
you go. So sometimes you can't help your mind and go there for a moment. So I felt a little traumatic in my gut. And so I pulled over, but thank God when he got to my car, he happened to be a very nice officer. He did not realize he had to yell because I'm driving, I'm focused. He's not in the car to put his sirens on. He's standing outside. So we traveling with a lot of other cars.
Right.
So he came over so nice. Hey, ma'am. Oh, I just wanted to. I think it had to be my inspection stick or something like that. But I was like, I had to take a deep breath. I was like, this is what people are experiencing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we experience trauma in the body. So it's like, I felt it all in my body. I was like, oh my God, I got so nervous. But when he came over, his spirit was different than it left me. But still, I could identify with having like that PTSD type of symptoms, like just getting nervous in your gut and, oh, man, I had to pray myself through that one.
Yeah.
Okay, so yes, the bad stuff. And you know, my daughter was diagnosed with COVID-19, but thank God she didn't have no intense symptoms. She
thank
had like
God.
A fever, a couple of aches for like 2 days, and then it went away, thank God.
Thank God,
and, I had everybody praying for her too. That was another little scare. Then I had to quarantine myself for her, so I couldn't really, as a mom, you're a parent, you want to take care of your child, nurture them, hug them, rub their head, get the cloth on their head. She had to do all of that. I had to stand from a distance while she, checked the temperature and all that. But
absolutely,
thank God it didn't take her, she didn't suffer too long with that.
Very good.
Yeah, that was another scare for me personally, the bad that happened.
Mm-hmm.
And when I was talking about the whole Black Lives Matter, you know, with the protests and bringing down a lot of these statues for us that represented racism or slavery, and
yes,
in Virginia, they did a whole lot of that, just pulling that down. And then the governor recently said they're going to put up some new statues.
Wow.
Having nothing to do with the Confederacy or nothing like that.
Right, right.
So I'm like, okay, that's good, you know? So I'm glad they again, like I said, the protests and the Black Lives Matter movement, it got somebody's attention that we're
yes,
no longer taking and just accepting and being passive. Like, those days are over.
Yes, yes.
Those days are over. We have a voice. So that came out of us coming together as a unity, the community.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, there was a gentleman in the particular neighborhood that I usually go through who had a Confederate sign up, a Confederate flag.
Right.
When he saw that I was frequently run that mm-hmm. in that area, because that my work
right.
is anyway, he took the flag down. So now I don't know why he did it.
Okay.
I applaud him for it.
Okay.
Maybe he's, you know, so I those are good things. It seems to be having a good effect around certain areas, and
right.
that's good. Hopefully it'll be everywhere. So right. I can say, I like that as well.
Exactly.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. So I want to talk about the lessons that we learned in 2020. Any personal lessons you learned in 2020 out of everything we talked about, everything that we experienced, good and bad?
Yeah, well, I've learned tenacity is important. Being that we've gone through so much this year, this has been a trying year.
Yeah.
Being that we've gone through so much, it can easily take you off your stance. You can
right.
easily be removed from your post, if you will.
Exactly.
I've learned to stand my post,
mm-hmm.
stay consistent, stay persistent, stay, like we talked about before, proactive, and stay
right.
in my lane. Stay in my lane.
You will, right, right.
Stay as a visionary, stay as prayerful.
Yes.
Stay as communicative, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
Reaching out, of course, with my
right.
kids. All my kids are grown, thank God. But
exactly.
stay as a dad.
Yes.
Just continue to, as far as my music, yes, just keep putting my whole heart into it and praying and pushing it through, regardless of what's going on, because a lot of people, we've lost a lot of artists this year.
Oh, my God.
We've lost actors, actresses.
That's a whole nother thing.
And so I've learned just to hang in there, Cheryl.
Yeah, I hear you.
Yeah.
I'll get to your music in a minute too, but I definitely hear you.
Okay.
And I know some of the things, lessons I learned, you did as well. Everything you just said. And then I've learned to, not that I didn't cherish families and friends before, but it makes me think about it even more. Cherishing,
yes.
cherishing family and friends, walking in health,
yes.
like taking that more seriously, you know,
yes.
with that, being tenacious with that, so I can right. enjoy the fruits of my labor.
Yes, absolutely.
I enjoy the lessons about self-care and mental health and helping other people understand what that is and helping other people become more conscious and proactive in taking care of themselves.
Yes.
Mentally, physically, spiritually, emotionally, all of that.
All of that.
Those are lessons I think a lot of us learned, that those things are important. Like the whole person that we are, you know, inside and out. Walking in love. And
yes.
also, yeah, walking in love. And, you know, I've been focused on that, like, the month of November, because, you know, I did self-care in, like, October. That was, like, focused on self-care. November, I started mm-hmm. doing workshops and writing about, you know, walking in love and loving self. And so even for those of you who are listening, if you follow me, or if you want to see some of the workshops I have that you can actually join, some free, some very low fee, I have mm-hmm. a workshop that I actually just put out called Learning How to Love You workshop. And you can
yes.
go to my Get Your Life Back Academy. I have an academy where I have a lot of different courses. I have ebooks you can download.
Yes.
Stuff about how to experience inner joy. I talk mm-hmm. about the God factor, because I don't believe we can have real joy without having God in our lives.
Absolutely.
You know, a lot of people
Absolutely.
Push God out of everything. And
Absolutely.
Really find joy, because see, being happy is based on what's happening. But
yes.
the joy that comes from inside
Excuse me.
With mm-hmm. God, and also joy that you get out of things that you love to do in friends and family and relationships.
Yes.
That gives
yes.
you a sense of joy and peace as well.
Mm-hmm.
So if you want to go into that masterclass, I'm telling you, it's a blessing. Learning how to love you, because again, we talked about self-care, where self-love is right up there with that, because there's people who don't love themselves for
yes.
a different reason, or maybe lost themselves and want to learn how to love, fall back in love with themselves again, with everything that you possess, you know, your strengths, your value. Right. And so that's what that masterclass is, actually like a masterclass workshop is all about. Right. And I also have one on inner joy and the God factor, like just right. acknowledging God in everything that we do.
Right.
So you can go again to Get Your Life Back Academy to sign up for that particular masterclass. So, you know, everything I do, David, I just try to think of other people. How can I be a blessing to other people? You know, not mm-hmm. being selfless, not being selfish, but selfless.
Yes,
and that's always been my prayer. God, I always want to be a blessing in all that I do. How can I be a blessing to somebody else? How can it help right. somebody else? Mm-hmm. So that was that. Goals. Now I want to get to that music in a minute. So goals, a lot of you have goals. Don't forget to leave some comments down here because I want to continue the conversation, those of you who are tuning in. A lot mm-hmm. of you have goals that we set out in 2020. Some of them are unfinished, right? Some of them, they delayed right now, but we can get right back okay. to it. I'm here to encourage somebody, don't give up on your goals. Because it didn't happen in 2020, it doesn't mean that you can't do it in 2021. Don't right. tell yourself that. A lot of times we held captive by our thoughts.
When yes.
When was in prison, we think, oh, we missed it. No, there's another chance. You know, and you know this too, David. Even sometimes if God do give you opportunity, say, this is your season to do this, and say you miss it, he doesn't just disqualify the whole time. Sometimes we just got to learn whatever lesson and no. realize, God, give me that season again. I'm ready this time. So if you want to look at things differently, not necessarily as a loss or failure, but what lesson did you learn out of that? And what you yes. do next time? You know, to make
exactly.
it better, be positioned, as David mentioned earlier, be on your post so when the opportunity comes again, you're ready this time. Because you
exactly.
have to learn those lessons sometime and even make us ready. Anything you want to say about that?
I'm sorry?
Anything you have to say on that?
Well, I want to go back to one of the lessons I've learned. One of the main lessons I've learned is not to take life for granted.
Right.
Again, we mentioned about people, loss of lives, whatever. But on that note, kind of like what you said, mm-hmm. this post is important. And
right.
if you're not at your post at a specific time, whatever, you could miss it. But you know what, though? It doesn't really matter because life goes on, so do you.
Right.
So you can find that time to do what you have to do. I mean, sometimes thresholds are important,
yeah.
and they are.
Yeah.
But we have the grace of God.
Yes.
And if God can use you back then when you missed it, he can use you now.
Exactly.
So don't be discouraged. Don't be all thrown out of, you can make it. You can get it done. So right. I encourage you all, just do it. Do it to your heart. Then make it work.
Amen. Still in the land
yes.
of the living. That means we still have yes. another chance.
Yes.
So like I was saying, though, there's unfinished business. Some of us got to get back to. Some of us, when I've seen, even with businesses, you know, there's a lot of loss. That's another loss. People have to close down their business because of what's
yes.
going on.
Yes.
Or they took a loss, financial loss in their business. My business mm-hmm. was hit. You know, part of my business besides making the natural products and stuff, I had to stop doing people's hair, the social distancing.
Right.
You know, to protect them and myself. So that was another chunk of income that I had mm-hmm. coming in. And then, you know, with my hours decreasing, even as being an essential worker, as a mental health counselor. So I took a cut and a loss in wages and in my income. So it's like experiencing all of that is a lot, but, you know, I thank God, you know, he gives us the spirit to be innovative and creative. He's a creator. So that means we create creative. A lot of people just don't know sometimes what they creative
right.
is what I'm looking for. Creativity.
Right.
Creativity is.
Creativity.
And I'm right. And that's, you know, I love to help people find that. But where was I going with that? Purpose and passion.
Mm-hmm.
Finding that purpose and passion as a goal and learning whenever your purpose and passion is, learn how to operate in it. And this is
yes.
the season for that. So like, again, I'm going back to how people lost businesses. I know a lot of people who had to rebrand.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes, and companies do it all the time. You see them
yes,
come back new and better, new and improved.
Yes.
It could
yes.
be a product or something. People
yes.
do it all the time. And I think a lot of people, David, beat themselves up when they the way they see stuff as a failure. And, but what keeps me is like, I see companies do it all the time. They come
yes,
out
they
with
do.
Something better, something greater. They may even rename their business. That's
yes.
part of the rebranding.
I've seen that a lot.
Right.
I've seen that a lot.
You know what I'm saying? So you don't have to count it as a total loss. What did you learn
right.
from it? Use it and keep going.
My yes.
brother went through that when he had opened up a gym. And because the people they was leasing the gym, I mean, he did so much work. Him and his friend Antonio, they built that place up. He had a gym. I was so proud of him. People coming in to work out. He had equipment. He restructured the inside, everything. Mm-hmm. And because, again, you know, it's always a little sketchy. And I remember years ago, somebody said, if you're going to get a business, try not to lease. Try to own the building. Because the landlord can always go up on the lease. And this is what happened in the situation. All of a sudden, he wanted them to lock in to like two or three year contract. Now, that's not easy to do when you have a client-based business you just started. So you're still trying to get in clientele. You're still marketing. You're the new kid on the block.
Yes.
You can't really lock into something unless you got a lot of capital, a lot of extra money. But you know, a lot of us small black-owned businesses, we trying to make it. And even if you're not small and black-owned, you know, there's two. In the beginning of your business, a lot of times, you don't really expect to see real money until maybe after 2 or 3 years. In the first couple of years, your money's going right back into the business. Sometimes you don't even have many profits after because the expenses growing your business. It goes right back into it. And so that's where he was. So, you know, because you know with gyms and stuff like that, people sporadic sometimes.
Yes.
Yeah, people come for a while, they're not coming. So he couldn't lock into it. So he had to shut the business down. So now he had his debt, which he's almost finished paying off, thank God. But what he decided to do, David, he came up with another strategy, and it was him and his partner decided to still do the physical fitness and training, but we just want to do one-on-one. They did the private or meet their clients out at the gym. So there was another way they had to kind of shift.
Yes.
I like that. It was inspiring to me because he didn't just give up totally. He said, okay, we're just going to meet with our clients. We're going to go where they are, whether it's at home, business, at the gym, still give them a workout strategy or plan and meal plan, all that stuff. And that's what they did. So a lot of people are doing that now. And for me, it was inspiring. I was like, wow, that's so great. You didn't just shut the door. Maybe he'll open one up again later. Who knows? But still, and a lot of people doing that. A lot of home-based businesses are being burned.
Yes.
Some of the good things happening. So you don't have to just close up on your visions and your dreams and your goals. So maybe you have to revamp. Maybe you have to reinvent. Maybe you have to rebrand.
Yes.
Maybe you have to wait a minute and start back up again, you know, but I know there's a lot of loss. You know, I've seen a lot of businesses just shut down, you know, based on that. And I actually I interviewed someone named Regina. She goes, I know her from back in New York. She used to work with me at the after school program and she sells jewelry. And I've seen that she did a whole rebranding through the midst of all this during the summertime. So I actually interviewed her. We talked about the whole rebranding and shifting because we was trying to inspire people not to give up on their dreams and goals. And so if anybody want to see that, again, go to my YouTube channel, Cheryl Howard, Get Your Life Back. And if you look up something called rebranding with Regina, you'll find that interview. It was very inspiring because she had to do some things as well in the midst of it all. Because she's been, from the time I know her, she started that jewelry business. She made her own jewelry. She don't sell anybody else's brand. Not knocking anybody else. But you know, I like making stuff with my hands. She creates her own jewelry. And I remember from the beginning of her business and where she is now, all over, just doing stuff. I had to have her on my show because I wanted to inspire somebody. But anyway, we're coming to the end of this podcast. And we're talking about what we are praying for going forward, now and then going forward. But wait, I want to back up because we talked about rebranding. You have some things coming down the pipeline, brother.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
What are you working on this season?
Yes, ma'am. I got some
music. That's an artist.
I got, as you all know, she introduced me as Dave LT. That's my stage name.
Dave LT.
I'm a gospel artist, but I don't stay with the genre of gospel per se. I got gospel jazz, gospel country, gospel, you name it, I got it. So my upcoming project I got coming out, it's a gospel country song called God's Love, but it's called Old Fashioned Love. Many of us know what that is. And I also have another project that I'm working on. It's called Rapture. It's a kind of like a jazzy type gospel song, but you'll hear it. It's coming up down the pipeline, probably early 2021. So you'll hear that.
That's awesome. I would say you don't have to say the name if you didn't want to, but that's cool. But that's awesome. That's real awesome. So, so that's something exciting to look toward doing. So you're actually working on an album of it, right?
Well, it's actually units to make an album.
Right.
I'm going to release a unit every 2 months.
Okay.
So at the end of the year, it'd be a full album. Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And what about you, Cheryl?
I was going to say, I still got a little bit of vocal ability left in the background.
You are on some of my projects already.
I didn't stop singing yet, guys, but you know, I'm just going to plug it. That's what you got to do. You got to put it out there.
That's it.
You never know. I've learned that even just in God. Sometimes you don't do it consciously. You speak and stuff because God knows who's going to be in the room. And then I had an experience where I felt led to put it out there and open up the door to something.
Yes.
So I put it out there.
Now I got plans for you. I got plans for you already.
All righty.
As you know.
So those are our prayers. You know, we're praying about that, things that we're looking forward to. What are you guys looking forward to? What are you still working on? What's your dreams? What's your visions for 2021? We're not going to do what they call every year. People try to come up with their own. Mm-hmm. I'm calling it visions, but their New Year's something. You know what I'm talking about? People always say, what's your New Year's? I can't think of that word right now.
Right.
I say vision. People say resolutions. That's what it is. Mm-hmm. However, we're talking about visions and dreams. What has God been speaking to you?
Right.
I encourage you to just stay in it. Stay in the fight. Hold on. Press towards it. Don't give up.
Right.
Take in all the lessons that you've learned this season. It may really be the thing that catapults you into your future, into your purpose, your passion, your destiny.
And, yes.
It's all how you see it. All things work together for the good to them who love God and who are called according to his purpose. So the good and the bad are working together. If you're still here in the land of the living, there's still much for you to do. There's still things that God has for you to do. And that's why you got to receive it and partner with God on it and just believe until it comes to pass. A lot of things that are birthed, as you know, David, it goes through, I'm thinking about earthquakes. I'm thinking about when something is about to come forth. I'm thinking about when a woman is about to give birth and the pains that come before she gives birth. It's not always an easy pregnancy. But sometimes that pregnancy was so hard. Mm-hmm. I'm thinking of one of my friends right now who had a daughter. She has so much in her. And it's like, just to go through all of that, to come out with this child, a daughter of hers, she's powerful. Let me tell you, she's prophetic. This little girl, I can talk about her. She's like my spiritual niece. I mean, but all the hell she went through, you look back, when I'm saying, it was like it was worth it because you don't even know. Some of you don't even know what God is birthing in you, what is going to come forth. Right now, you see the pain, you see the earthquakes, you see the topsy-turviness, all the crazy stuff, and it looks like it's not going to happen. And I had seen that, like, God, is this thing going to really happen?
But exactly.
When it happens, it's like everything you have endured, it's like a dream. It's like, did that even happen? Like, how did I even get through it? Because now you're on the other side, and all the stuff you went through sometimes becomes like a dream. Like, wow. It seemed long when you're in it, the process.
Yes. Yes.
The pressing. But you know, we're going to chill because we can easily go into a priesthood. But anyway, but yeah, my prayer for everyone is health and prosperity, healing, restoration. And I also have a video I also did because I did a prayer. I did an intercessory prayer for such a time as this. And it's on my YouTube other channel, Healing for Your Soul Ministries. And so there's a prayer called the Intercessory Prayer on YouTube. You can go to Healing for Your Soul Ministries and you'll see that prayer. But I just felt led that day, David, just all the things that we have gone through, to just go into intercessory prayer. And I know it's a blessing to a lot of people, but we need the restoration personally, and we need it nationally and all across the world.
Yes, we do.
We need that restoration, healing emotionally, spiritually, physically, mentally. We need restoration. We need healing. And prosperity in all areas, not just financially. Yes. Prosper in relationships. Prosper, that could be family, that can be friends, work relationships, whatever. Prospering in our health, even as our soul prosper. So that's what I kind of wanted to pray for. That's my prayer, actually, for all of us.
That
we prosper in every area of our life and that we come out of this thing that 2021 is going to be better. We're going to be healed and whole. The pandemic is going to be gone, erased. Just, you know, we're going to overcome that. We're going to be able to get back to normal again. But we're also going to have some new things that are going to be great that came out of this. Some of us have lives that changed for the better because of it. And I thank God for that as well. And while we're still here, we can still make a difference. We can still have a positive impact on people around us and people that we encounter.
That
is my prayer. David, I was going to ask you, man of God, to say a word of prayer, if you don't mind.
Okay, so I want all of you right now to just lift your hands right now, just to look to heaven right now. There's a God in heaven that cares about you. He wants you to know that even though we're in the midst of a pandemic, he's still God.
Yes.
And there's healing in the land right now because Jesus is right now walking amongst us right now. Yes. So we just want to believe God right now that a difference is coming. We may not see it, we may not hear it, we may not smell it, but God is working in the midst right now. Mm-hmm. So just receive your healing. Receive the fact that God is giving, this is a new start. This is a new jump off, new launch to what you're doing. Let's forget about the losses of last year and take and embrace what God sets before you, which is your visions, your plans, all your blessings, and take life and just jump at it and just give God the glory in the process of it, and just know that God's in control. Amen. In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name, amen. Mm. I'm such and agree with you. Two or three gathered together, God is great in the midst. So I thank God for all that. I thank God for what he's going to do. I thank God for what he's doing in your life even right now. Some of you see it, some of you don't see it, but when it comes out, you're going to be able to look back and go, wow.
Yes.
You know, I thank God for that, because we experience seasons like that.
Yes.
You know, we don't always see the end. He show you a glimpse sometime. He show you the size of a man, a cloud the size of a man's hand, or give you some prophecy in part, and you don't see the whole thing, but that sometimes is enough to keep you holding on to see what the end is going to be. You know, to see what the end of the tunnel looks like. You know that there's a brighter day coming. And so a lot of times we're holding on to holding on. I mean, I always say that sometimes when I find myself against the wall in certain situations and you're really trying to hold on, I'm like, God, I'm literally holding on to the holding on. So I know some of you know what that feels like. So you're trying to hold on to not giving up, basically.
Yeah.
So don't give up. Be encouraged. Be motivated. Follow me again. I have so many different videos that are inspirational, motivational, sharing my story, other people's story, and a lot of strategies that really help you cope and just cope with not only your personal things, but cope with everything that's going on around you in your environment, and just staying focused. Mr. Dave LT, I want to thank you for joining me.
Thank you for having me. Thank you.
I don't know how long we stayed on, but it was really, really, really fun. And I look forward to doing some more podcasts with you.
And we will.
And we will. Thank you, everybody. Take care. We see you again. God be with you. Bye-bye.
Peace. Love y'all.